So we're going to begin. We're missing a key member of this group, but we're going to begin in any event. A member of the MWRTA is on his way. He's called and said that he's running late due to traffic. So we can all appreciate that. And when he finds his way through the traffic, he's going to find parking a challenge as well. So first of all, I'd like to welcome everyone and thank everyone for participating tonight. This is the second forum of three that we would like to hold concerning public transportation in Milford and the possibilities of public transportation. I would consider this fact-finding. There's a great deal that goes into this. There's a great deal of thought that needs to go into to do it well. We're trying to understand from the citizens of Milford, the town officials, what particular challenges might exist, what opportunities exist, and how we navigate through this process. As many of you know, part of the process that we did for this meeting, Rick sent out notices to all town officials and departments, committees, town meeting members, in order to get a broad cross-section of folks that needed to understand this better, for people that had concerns. So it's okay to support this. It's okay to ask questions about it. It's okay to challenge it. That's what the forum is for. We're going to try to get answers. We don't necessarily have them all tonight. I'll say right up front as an example, we don't know what the final route will look like. We've got a proposed route, but the final route is going to be one that we have to craft ourselves. I think there are portions of it. When I look at the example map, I see lots of great ideas. So I think this is going to be the basis for what we would eventually see should this be approved at town meeting. For town meeting members, I would encourage you to participate in make sure you're at the town meeting, and to encourage other town meeting members to attend. This is not more important than other town meetings. We always do important business at town meetings, but this is certainly one of the things that will be coming up in the next town meeting, and we want to hear from everybody. Great to see such a great cross-section of town meeting members, public officials, appointed, elected, and also concerned citizens. This is exactly what we were hoping for when we talk about public forums and discussion about what our community is going to look like in the future, specifically as it relates to the availability of public transportation. I think each in our own way, from the members of the Board of Selectmen, have voiced support for public transportation. I think it offers a great deal as current chairman. There are a wide variety of things that are not necessarily going to show up in a spreadsheet, as I've said before. We look at finances. Finances are important to this community, but also quality of life. This is always going to be about quality of life. With that said, though, there is always going to be a cost associated with that. We need to figure out how to process that cost, how to deliver the best service. And hopefully we can gain support over this process, but what I'd like to do now is introduce the folks that are sitting at the front table in front of us. So I'll let them introduce themselves just in case. Go ahead, Rick.
I'm Rich Milani, I'm the town administrator.
Hi, everyone. I'm Harold Rhodes, chairman of the Commission on Disability and town meeting member, precinct 2.
Hi, I'm Eva Williams. I'm deputy administrator of the Metro West Regional Transit Authority.
Brian Murray, a member of the Board of Selectmen.
Carl Damagello, Metro West Regional Transit Authority. I'm the Director of Community Relations for the MWRTA.
I can vouch for that.
Who was just navigating through the traffic in the community and outside the community. So what I would like to do is not stand in front of this microphone and say a lot, but what I would like to do is just again welcome everyone, and I would encourage you to speak if you have an idea, if you have a thought, if you have a concern. They may well be something that we haven't thought of. So just to let you know a little bit about the process that's happening behind the scenes prior to upcoming town meeting. The town administrator has reached out to all the department heads, committees, and asked for feedback. And specifically, it asked, what are the opportunities that public transportation can provide from your perspective? The second thing it said is, what are the risks or what are the challenges? What do you see that might present a unique challenge to your particular department? Something that maybe we didn't think of that we should have concern about. And then the other piece of it obviously asked, are there ways in which you would recommend mitigating those risks or challenges? So it's one thing to find the problem, it's another thing to say, okay, here's how I might solve that. I think for most of the people, from what I read of the surveys, they're also here, the town officials are also here to better understand what this means and what it represents for the community of Milford. We've not had public transportation. And for anybody who's tried to ever get a cab or get assistance to travel somewhere, they know what a challenge that can be. But we've had the opportunity to listen and read and hear from the various department heads, and hopefully we'll give them the opportunity to hear more and maybe re-ask their question. I'd ask the folks that submitted surveys to go ahead and consider repeating your comments so that the broader public can hear it, not just the members of the Board of Selectmen, so that people can process those thoughts and where you think the opportunities are, what the benefits are, and where the risks are. And I'd also encourage anybody to come up and speak. I'll try to moderate that, but we'll have to come to this microphone because that's the way this is set up, the microphone for community television, who's also recording this event for the benefit of people who could not be here. So I'd ask that you come to the podium and ask your question or make your comment, and then we'll see what we can do about answering your question. Or if nothing else, maybe we don't have the answer. Maybe we'll need to get back to you. So with that, I want to open it up. Would anybody like to be the first to address this group and talk to the members? Carl, I don't know if there's anything that you particularly want to say tonight. Do you want to open up, break the ice for us?
I think I'd like to yield to my deputy administrator.
Okay. We'll need you at the microphone just for the benefit of the microphone for the camera. Thank you.
Just a few words. Just on behalf of the administrator, Ed Carr, he was sorry that he couldn't be here tonight. But we are thrilled that Milford is an addition to the Transit Authority. And we look forward to working with the town of Milford and the residents of Milford to bring a consistent bus route to the town. It would give the opportunity for folks to access public transportation, not only in the town of Milford, but as part of the broader bus system. As you know, it's been proposed to go to Milford Hospital, and there's also several other hospitals on our bus system that it would give folks access to. Also, you know, job opportunities and education and shopping and whatever else was needed or wanted for people to go to. So, you know, if you have any questions for us, you know, we'll be happy to try and answer that. Carl has a lot of answers. And yeah, so please ask away. Thank you.
These aren't my notes, by the way. I don't want you to think that I have a lot to talk about, because I really don't. I want to hear more from the people of Milford than have you hear about from me. The reason I had Eva go first is because she's a little more pleasant on the eyes than I am.
A lot more.
Yeah. Thanks, Bill. What I'm going to do is I'm going to hand these out. There are two different sheets here. One is the Route 6, and the Route 6 currently right now for the MWRTA goes into Milford. It goes into Milford twice a day, early in the morning and later on in the afternoon. And that's more for employment and people going to the commuter rail in Framingham. It's also, for the rest of the day, it goes into Holliston as far as Mission Springs. The other one is the system map, sorry, cable TV, the system map, which is that map over there, and I'm sure that all of you, even if you might have 20/20 vision, can't see the way that map is. So I'm going to just hand these out now, and, oh, thank you, Rick. What we're proposing to do tonight is to, as Bill had said, get your input for some of the stuff that we might have missed. Now, I know that when we first had our first presentation at the Senior Center, the map that was presented at that time is this map over to my right. The map actually is drawn up from a list of locations within the town of Milford that basically I was given the list and then I had to connect the dots so that we could make this sort of work in the best possible way. This is not etched in stone. The final decision will be made through the chairman of the Board of Selectmen and the administrator for the MWRTA. So if there are any changes to be made, it can be made along the way before this process goes into effect. Also, when we get it into play, we will have the opportunity to change the route at any time. This is similar to the most recent fixed route that we've done since Milford was proposed, was in the town of Wellesley. And that was changed numerous times because, again, we were given a list of where they would like to have seen us go, and then we fine-tuned it to make the time more efficient. Okay? So with that, I will yield the mic and open it up to the floor.
So everybody has the handout and sees that the transportation that we're talking about and proposing is part of a very much broader system. The MWRTA goes to the locations that are shown on those maps, centered and headquartered in Framingham, is that right,
yeah,
Carl? So it provides, not only does it provide the transportation that we're talking about, provide greater access intra-Milford, but also can provide access outside of Milford to different shopping areas or hospitals. I'm going to start off with a question. So I, not having been to a MWRTA meeting yet, I want to see and ask the question. If it can't be answered tonight, that's fine. One of the questions I had is there a possibility to put routes to the commuter rail stations in Southboro and Franklin? And the reason why I say that is I think there's a great deal of members of our community who travel into Boston who use those routes, and for various reasons use either the Franklin or Southboro train locations, MBTA train stations. And I wanted to see what the possibility was of having those included as part of our route system.
Well, one of the things that we need to look at, if that is a possibility, is first of all, Franklin is not within the Metro West Regional Transit Authority geographic area. Franklin is covered by GATRA, which is the Greater Attleboro-Taunton Regional Transit Authority. So in order to change over into another district or area that has a different RTA, we would have to make a connection somehow close to the line of the Metro West Regional Transit Authority and GATRA. The closest place that could be done right now would be at the Medway-Holliston town line. Medway does not supply a commuter bus at this time from the GATRA end of it because of the fact that they haven't got a great need for a bus service to go to the Franklin line. I can understand that Franklin can be more preferable to people that live in Milford. The traffic might be a little easier for them to get there. The only problem is that we go directly to the commuter rail in Framingham because it's more direct for our routes. If you look at your sheet that has the system map on it, that's the thing that looks like a spider. You can see that right now what we do is we have what's called commuter shuttles that go to the commuter rail station in Southborough, Framingham, Natick, Wellesley. There's two in Wellesley, actually, that we go to. But we do not go to Southborough from the south, from Framingham, from Holliston, Hopkinton, or Milford in the future, because we just don't think it's feasible. It would pick up enough passengers along the way to do that. This would not be sort of set up so that it's just for Milford commuters to get to the most convenient commuter rail station. It would be set up more so that it can go to where the more people being served. Right now, we pick up in our morning run. If you look at your Route 6 schedule, we come into Milford and pick up in front of the town hall. And in front of the town hall, what we do is we take anybody that's going to the commuter rail right directly to Framingham. It's more of an express than anything else. So
is that done today, like every day?
It's been done for ever since the MWRTA has been in inception. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. If you go out there tomorrow morning, according to that schedule, you can take the Route 6 bus into Framingham. We have a lot of people in Milford that work in Framingham, and that's how they get to their jobs. I hope that answers the question for you, Bill. This is my wingman.
So let me correct a few things. This is something that Bill and I have been talking about for the last 6 months, is how we coordinate with the commuter rail. It's something which is very important to the folks here who live here in Milford. And one of the things that Bill came up with, you know, as the follow-on to this, is to establish a transportation committee, a transportation advisory committee, to monitor the transportation needs of the community as we go forward. One of the opportunities we have as a future add-on to what we're doing here with the transportation is provide a direct shuttle from Milford to the commuter rail system. Now, we're beginning to flesh that out. That might even include a municipal parking lot so people can just park here and pick up the commuter rail, and we would work out the timing. So we, you know, Bill and I have talked about this. We know that this is a very important thing to do for all of us who would rather go to Boston without traveling on the Mass Pike or 495, and is the next thing to be considered by the Transportation Advisory Committee, and ideally I'd like to be a part of that. But we'll see. Go ahead.
I definitely agree with Bill about reaching Southborough and reaching Franklin. There are several college students that are in Boston. I mean, I've made many of trips to Southborough and to Ashland. There's a route on here that actually does go to Ashland. Mm-hmm. That it's right in South Street at EMC. So as far as linking up with that, and that would give also two people going to Worcester. I mean, to go to Framingham, and let's say if you wanted to go to Worcester, would that be a consideration? I mean, we also have students in Worcester as well. But you know, I think that I agree with Bill as far as like Southborough, Ashland is on the same route, or to Franklin serves Milford as much as, if not more than Framingham.
I
work in Framingham. I only go to Framingham to go to work. I go back ways. I mean, but I have a car. I mean, but it's not, you know, as far as other avenues to look.
Again, this is, you know, Bill Bill has thought about this and, you know, has heard this comment and, you know, embraced it to the point that as we get through bringing public transportation here within Milford, we'll come back, you know, provided the, you know, the Board of Selectmen support it and other groups support it, with a proposal to include additional transportation opportunities because those things are as well needed, okay?
Go ahead, Joe.
Joe, go ahead.
I have a series of questions. Number one, this is a proposed route for the town of Milford, am I correct?
Correct. What you're looking at is on the boards are the intra Milford stops.
The question here is, has there ever been a study done on the number of people that are going to take this on a daily basis?
Joe, thank you very much for asking that question. The decision to begin to look into public transportation actually began about 16 months ago when I asked the Board of Trustees if this would be something to look at. And the due diligence was extensive. I have here the actual projected numbers for transportation here within Milford, and I'll share that with you, which is...
Could you tell us?
Yes, and let me just explain the methodology. I went to Pat Morrill, who's in the back. I went to Ellen Friedman for the hospital, Siobhan Bahansen for the chamber, Maria Bradley, who's here, Sue Clark, Bob Tremblay, and John Pila, and I asked them, on your own, what do you think would be the high and the low? And they gave me their numbers. So these numbers come directly from them. I simply added that up. So we're estimating over 260 days. Okay, so that's 52 weeks, five days a week. On one hand, about 29,000, and that would be about 9 passengers per hour, which is very reasonable in consideration with all the other bus routes. In fact, that's a little lower than what the other community bus routes are, up to a high as much as 50,000, which represents about 14 riders per hour. And I can share the analysis with you so you can see.
Questions that I have. These are estimates, am I correct?
Yeah.
Is there, the passengers that are going to be taking these buses, are they paying a fare at all?
Yes, they are.
What would the fare be?
The fare structure for an adult would be, if they do not have a Charlie card, $1.50 for a one-way with one transfer in the same direction. Does everybody understand that? Because that's very important.
What's a one-transfer?
One transfer is, if you took a bus from Milford and wanted to go to Framingham, even though you would make a transfer to another bus in Holliston right now, you would not take into consideration the transfer until you get on the next bus in Framingham, okay? So that means that you could actually get on a bus in Milford, the furthest point in Milford, take the Route 6 bus into Framingham, get on the Route 7 bus, and go to downtown Marlborough for $1.50. If you have a Charlie card, that same fare, or the same trip, would be $1.25. If you're a student, it's $1. And for a senior that is either senior or disabled, it would be 70 cents for that same trip. So 70 cents to get from Milford to downtown Marlborough. I have another answer for you as far as the question that you had in the first one for the estimate. I don't know how many in this room right now realize that we have a survey going on the Milford website. And the survey is basically the fastest and easiest way for more people that use that survey to give us an idea of, are you going to use the bus if we have public transportation in Milford? And right now, that's the only fair way we can get some sort of an idea is through some sort of a survey. I know that the figures that Harold gave you are an estimate of people that are very responsible and respectable to give their figures as to what they think. But again, we're only guessing. We have to get a true idea from the people that are going to answer the survey.
Another question.
Yes, sir.
Your low figure here is about 250, the high about 29,000, the high 58,000, cut in half, let's say 40,000, at a buck 50, that's $60,000 a year, yet we're asked to appropriate a quarter of a million. Now, two questions that I'm going to ask at town meeting, so you better know it now. What's the recommendation of the Board of Selectmen, recommendation of the Finance Committee? Because you see, personally, and I'm going to tell you exactly what I feel, I don't think this is necessary. I've lived in this town all my life. We have a bus transportation from the senior center. This is something that is going to be Pandora's box. Once it's opened, you are not going to close it. That's my feeling. Thank you.
I honestly can't answer how the Finance Committee of the Board of Selectmen are giving as far as their recommendation. I can't answer that. But one of the things is that the only way we're going to be able to see if this would work, and I understand that throwing that figure out there is very expensive for the town to come up with to appropriate. But one thing you have to understand is right now we have a grant promise from the Milford Hospital that they are willing to kick in on this $75,000 for the next 3 years. So that's going to reduce the amount of money that the town of Milford has to kick in. The other thing, too, that our administrator is working with your representative, Fernandez, to see if the state can come up with some money to help defray the cost of this public transportation within the town of Milford because of what it's going to serve within the town of Milford. If they come up with some sort of a figure that's going to reduce the cost, and this is just a ballpark, could be down to a figure of $50,000 that the town would have to come up with to run a bus service within the town for 13 hours a day, 5 days a week. So it's more in line, sir, with what you are coming up with for the figure to run the bus service, but we still haven't got, the only money we have promised right now is Milford Hospital.
And let me just add a point to respond to Joe's question. The Board of Selectmen voted unanimously to take this article forward to the town meeting. I hope that answers that question, or does it?
Well, you can take it forward, Billy, but you've always lied on it.
No,
somebody's going to ask you for recommendation.
What's that?
Somebody's going to ask for recommendation of the Board of Selectmen and the Finance Committee.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the Finance Committee's position is. We take that article tomorrow night, but the Board of Selectmen have recommended to go forward with this, so I look at that as a favorable vote, and we, as far as I know, the members of the board intend to support this. Let me say this. So first of all, the numbers that have been used tonight are all accurate. The number that Joe used in terms of what we're looking for at town meeting is accurate, and the numbers that Carl just represented in terms of what the hospital has offered for a grant is also accurate. But having said that, there isn't a public transportation system in the world that's not running without subsidy. So be clear that public transportation, by its very nature, requires some subsidy. Now, how you feel about that can be varied, and we could poll the members of this room and they could all feel differently about that, but that's a fact. There isn't any public transportation out there system that works that isn't subsidized by taxpayer funds.
Since we talked about Chennai, I asked Alan Friedman to come up.
Yes.
Yeah.
Please. And we'll come right back. You don't.
Hi everyone, Ellen Friedman from Chennai 6, over here. I'm Ellen Friedman, I am the chair of Chennai 6, which many people probably don't know what Chennai 6 is. Should I explain what Chennai 6
please.
Is? Okay. Chennai 6, Chennais are the community health network areas, and they're across the state. They're developed by the Department of Public Health. And this region here, which is 11 communities, and this region is Chennai 6, there's about 20 Chennais across the state. And Chinaz received funds when hospitals do community capital improvements, and hospitals do build or buy capital items. And so our hospital, as you know, Milford Regional, has just done an enormous improvement, and 5% of those funds come to the local Chinaz. And that's over the span of 5 to 8 years. So we have about $300,000 a year over the next 5 to 6, maybe 7 years, depending on how we allocate it, for community programs. And these community programs are all developed through a community health improvement plan. So the CHNA has been working for the past 18 months to develop this community health improvement plan, so we were ready for these funds that were coming into the community. And one of the priority areas for the CHNA was access to care. And access to care among one of the larger initiatives was transportation. So there was a proposal from the town of Milford for transportation to the CHNA, and we agreed to fund that proposal, which is a proposal you see here tonight, which we've been talking about tonight, and it is really only for this proposal. It's not for some other proposal. If there's some other proposal, that's another something that would be presented to the CHNA next year. So this is an annual fund, and these funds are have been allocated. They're $75,000, which is the highest amount that the CHNA awarded to different organizations. It is to be used within this year, and if it's not used within this year, then it rolls back into the fund, and a reapplication can be put in. So a lot of these things don't apply for other grants that we've funded, but it does apply to this grant. So the funding isn't really from the hospital. It's the hospital funds the community, and then the community is funding the proposals. And as I said, access was one of the key areas. We also funded proposals in substance abuse prevention and behavioral health, violence prevention, and chronic disease prevention. So we funded 7 large initiatives to about $370,000, and this was one of our this was unanimously supported because it fit so clearly with the intent of the community health improvement plan. Beverly,
the $75,000,
yes,
is a grant,
right?
Correct. And so the $75,000 isn't automatically given. You have to reapply for it every year. Is that correct?
Correct.
So it's $75,000
for 1 year.
For 1 year.
At this application,
not
yes.
For 3 consecutive
right.
Years.
Right. Right. And there are some in the future. We may do some multiple year grants, but being the first year that we've done this, we decided we would just fund programs for 1 year.
And in the grant, the hospital actually isn't just the person that the organization is screening. It's your CHNA group that's
right. 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 So I do hold 2 different roles, one with the hospital and one with the CHNA. And in many communities, there's multiple hospitals, and maybe someone from one of the hospitals is involved with the CHNA. But we have about, at this point, 70 partner organizations, many of which are here. Almost all the town organizations are involved, but it does represent 11 towns. So we have all the contiguous towns who are also involved. So we had mentioned a lot of the towns we had mentioned here. People, they want to get around Milford, but they also want to get to some of the other towns, or some of the other towns want to get to Milford. So it's not strictly just to get people from Milford around, although that is a key element, but also servicing other towns like we've talked about, from Franklin to, Hopkinton, Holliston. Yeah. Any other questions? The other thing, I did want to follow up on the comment about ridership, and I wondered if Wellesley, which is one of your newer communities, if you have any information or analysis on the ridership in Wellesley. I know that it's a different community, but I think just sort of starting something new, and if you see how quickly a new community takes on this.
Yeah, I don't have those numbers right offhand, but it is, like you said, a very different community, and it's not the roots. This is a lot denser in Milford, and the opportunity for ridership, I think, is a lot greater than it would be in Wellesley.
It's greater here, you feel?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Anybody have any other questions about the CHNA? Call them up here.
I want to go back to what Donna had at the end of that comment. Thank you.
My question focused on the CHNA grant, because it's Carl, if I understood you correctly, I think you mentioned that that grant would be available for the next 3 years, but yet we do not have any confirmation that that will actually be the situation. So the $75,000 would go toward the first year of the contract, but not necessarily the other two.
It would be working on the success of what the actual fixed roof does for providing transportation, as Alan said. And it, the more people that we serve, the easier it would be to get that grant again.
You can apply for the grant again.
Right.
Right, the first year has been applied for and been awarded, and any subsequent year would have to be reapplied for. Jeff?
Bill, just another follow-up to Kyle, too. Kyle mentioned that the legislature is working to give money to the town as a grant. But correct me if I'm wrong, if they give us money, it doesn't come right off our bottom line, so it's still going to cost the town. Just correct me if I'm wrong there.
Well, so I don't know how that's structured, and I don't know what's in the works. I would say that's not the case. I would say that what we're looking for are either a stable line item within a budget from the state, or we're looking for grants from the state. And that's been from very brief conversations with Representative Fernandez. What comes off the top from local aid is the money that we would apply to from local funds. So that comes right off the top to go towards public transportation. So the article that town meeting members see in front of them, or would see in front of them at town meeting, would be money that came directly from local aid that would go directly to the MWRTA to operate this service. That's what comes off the top for sure. Anything else that John happens to be working on, or Senator Fatman are working on, would be either in the form of grants or in the form of a line item in the state budget.
I just thought I read there was an offset on the charter sheet if this comes in. That's what I thought. I read something.
There, my understanding is that's not the case.
No.
That what they're working on now is that there's no offset. That's a good question. Mr. Swimer. Then you're next. I apologize.
The article we're going to be asked to vote on is for $250,000?
That's correct.
Okay. Let me give you a little breakdown from a taxpayer's point of view what $250,000 means to me. If you had 100 regular riders a week, say 100 people constantly get on that bus every week, which is a reasonable amount of people, you're asking the taxpayers to pay $2,500 for each one of them as a transportation subsidy. If it was 250 people a week, you're asking the taxpayers of Milford to pay $1,000 for each one of them a year. That's a large number. Some other numbers I've seen, Sue Clark, great job, senior said a wonderful thing.
I know something's coming, George. Go ahead.
I understand she provides a service to the citizens of Milford out of the senior center. It costs roughly $50,000 to $60,000 a year. I wonder for $250,000 how many more vans and insurance and drivers we could get to run out of the senior center for $250,000 as an alternative. The reason I bring that up, those two extra vans, which are say in the $100,000 to $110,000 range, I could conceivably satisfy any need by the handicapped of Milford who desperately need a service, and I'm more than happy to help pay for that. So in the idea of helping the handicapped in Milford with a couple of extra vans coordinated out of the senior center, I think would be a worthwhile alternative. Maybe not the best solution, but an alternative.
Okay. Let me just stop you just for a second, because I'm sure there's more, but I want to address it while my capacity to remember your questions is capable. So your first point with regard to subsidy is, I'm not going to question the numbers. I haven't done the math that you've done, so I'd have to go back and look at it. But as I began, I said that there's absolutely subsidy. And I do expect that as town meeting members wrangle with the question of whether this is worth it or not, they're going to be going through their own gyrations in terms of what that means to their budget, what that means to their home, But also, I'm hoping that, as I said earlier, that this wasn't going to be entirely a spreadsheet discussion. And the only way I can say it from my perspective, because I tend to be fiscally conservative as well, is this means a lot of things to a lot of people that would need that subsidy. So we're talking about, and I'll only tell you how I came to support the article. When we talk about access to care, we're talking about people who might not otherwise have the means. We're also talking about people who would gain a benefit who have the means. We're talking about veterans who need to go into the VA to Boston. We're talking about people who need to access care, not just in Milford, but in Framingham, and are sometimes sent to a specialist in Boston. Those aren't always people that have access to transportation otherwise. We're also talking about access to work. For a great many people who might be of some means, it may mean that they are putting less into their car maintenance. Maybe they're running one car instead of two. Maybe they're avoiding the tolls and the various things, and instead going to the MBTA and going to work in Boston. Now, that could be somebody who's in the financial district, or it could be somebody other than that. But what it does from a quality of life, from my perspective, is it allows access, much like a train does in Franklin, to get to jobs in Boston, jobs in Framingham, and still live in this community. The other thing that I'm not sure how to portray it, I think there's an opportunity for greater business growth. I don't think people are always going to leave Milford. I think the intra-bus aspect of the bus service is a big piece of what can make this community thrive. I think if people have greater access to the shops in Milford, the stores in Milford, and not just the box stores, but I'm talking about the little boutique shops, there's a greater chance that businesses along Main Street might grow and might do and prosper just from having the transportation that allows somebody to go from either their home or a nearby street to Spallone's. And I'm not doing a commercial for Spallone's, but I just mentioned that as one of the long-standing multi-generational businesses in town. Stop by at the library and then go back home. I think that's what the intra-bus, so I'm not trying to compete.
I don't disagree with anything you say, all wonderful things, but basically the premise behind servicing that population is you're shifting the expense on that population to a population that perhaps doesn't necessarily need that service.
Absolutely. Yeah, there's no question. I freely give you the subsidy and tell you that there is subsidy.
That's a policy issue. I'm just talking numbers.
Yep.
So
you would have to get your brain around the concept of the subsidy and say, yes, I'm either for or against the subsidy subsidizing this service.
The other thing is I keep thinking of the times I listen to the meetings you guys have, and I every once in a while get a kick out of some of the language that's various selectmen use, and I remember Brian in one of his meetings says, since we're such a well-managed town, let's not get giddy about spending money. So I'm a little bit worried about our philosophy from a town meeting point of view shifting to more of a not giddy, but certainly, well, we've got this money, let's figure out a way to spend it kind of approach. My reason being that I do think there are alternatives that are less expensive that meet the needs of the disabled, to meet the needs of the medically needy, and they are not inclusive in public transportation. That's just my comment. One other point of comparison, we just are about to open a very beautiful, wonderful thing for the kids of Milford. What is the annual budget of that facility over there? Is that a quarter of a million a year? Is it less? Is it more? I don't know. But certainly $250,000 off the taxpayers. Once again, it's a policy issue. $250,000, if we had this in a room and we could go reach into that drawer and pull out $250,000, maybe helping $250,000 in this new endeavor we've encountered might have been a more another alternative way to spend money. If we're looking at ways to spend money, that's all I'm commenting.
No, no, that's not accurate. At least that wouldn't characterize my perspective on it. But let me say this. Within government, we subsidize a great many things where people wouldn't get greater benefit. So as a school system, as an example, we subsidize the school system, and those folks who don't have children are subsidizing that process for the greater benefit. There are people who today are not driving cars, but yet pay taxes and do things for roads and roads and road improvement. So everywhere along the line you look at government, there is a subsidy of somebody who is not gaining a benefit but paying a subsidy and subsidizing for a greater benefit. But I think for me, it came down to a more human aspect, at least from my perspective. And it was the human aspect of being able to help people who otherwise might not be able to get the benefit of the jobs, the healthcare services and all of that. But there's also a piece that I believe that improves the quality of life beyond that. I think we'll attract people to buy our homes. I think our values increase from people who are able to, and I'll give you an example that's personal. My son-in-law works for the federal government in Boston. He would much prefer to take a bus to a location that gets him on the MBTA, which he's already traveling on, than have the necessary expenses associated with another car. Now, that's just a personal observation, one example from somebody who works for the FDIC. Now, that's not somebody who might otherwise not have the means. It's a matter of convenience, and it's a matter of benefit to somebody that might take advantage of a bus ride instead of having the either the additional car or the use of the car, as an example. There's people that do that in Boston all the time. I mean, Franklin, all the time. They get on the MBTA, and they travel into Boston. They work and live in their communities, but travel into Boston and other communities to work. I promised I would pick Lena next, and I apologize, Lena, for the delay.
I just have,
and then Brian would like to say something as well.
Okay. I just have one question. When I look at the total of $250,000 and I think about what Joe Arcudi said, is this a contract that we're going to have for 3 years? How long is this contract going to be for? And if it is for 3 years and it does not work, can we pull out of it?
The answer to your question is yes. We can stop the service. We can pull out of it if it's not working.
Having said that, do you think, how would the town meeting members be part of that contract saying, okay, we're not happy with it? How would that all?
There is currently no contract. We're in a very unique.
There is no contract.
Right. We're in a very unique situation. We're not in the catchment area for the MWRTA. I know I'm using state words.
So my question, the other thing is that I think this is very immature to bring this to the town meeting members at this time.
Okay.
I don't think it's a full package enough for me personally to say that, yeah, I'm for this.
What would you like to see, as an example, this is part of the vetting process, what would you like to see that, so that you might make an
Well, I'd like to know about the contract. I'd like to know how long the contract is going to be. If it's going to be 3 years. I'd like to, as a town meeting member, I'd like to know that if it's not working, we can get out of it. I'd like, you know, there are a lot of questions, and I think that's only at the top of my head, but it is a lot of money, and George, you did a great job. But I received all this information in the mail today, and I went down to see Rick because I was surprised about when I looked at everything you have to do on this van in 3 years, it may that 250 may go up. I mean, it may need new tires, or you know, it needs to be serviced, and. The other part of it was, I talked to Rick about it, was this printout about where it starts from. Holliston, Temple. This is really not the right way they're going to go, right? This is like, it only gets, it goes from Holliston, but it doesn't go back. Did everybody receive?
Yes, it does today.
I mean, it was really kind of.
It does it twice a day today.
It was misleading, I think.
Okay.
I'm going to ask Carl to answer a piece of the question about the contract. One of the things that everybody has to understand is there is no contract. There'll be no contract between the town of Milford and the MWRTA. We have 15 member communities presently. Milford happened to be the last community to join the MWRTA at this point. And Milford is an unusual situation, as I'm sure that you've all heard in the past, is you don't get an assessment from the MBTA because you don't either have a commuter rail or border a town that has a commuter rail in it. Now, Holliston doesn't have a commuter rail that goes in it, but we have an assessment. The Holliston assessment is roughly around $85,000. We use that funding that normally we would have had to pay to the MBTA to pay for the service that Holliston gets from the MWRTA, okay? So you have to understand that it's going to be, if Milford all of a sudden says, we don't see that this is working, then you could pull out of that contract at any, not contract, you could pull out of the agreement at any time. There will be nothing in writing that needs to be done to carry on the service for the town of Milford. Right now, you're getting two runs into Milford for free. Okay. Mm-hmm. Will that change if Milford votes down to have a fixed route? I don't think so, because there's enough service that we're providing and there's enough people that are using that service twice a day to keep us running into Milford in the morning and then back again in the evening. And it's important to those people. When we look at this, because I'm sure that Sue doesn't want to take on the responsibility of five or six vans that are going to transport people, and not just seniors, but the residents of the town of Milford, to provide transportation for them all day long, 5 days a week. I don't think she has the support to handle something like that, and I'm going to tell you that it's probably going to be close to the one bus that we can run for her to be able to provide all the transportation that you need. Now, I don't know what the times are that the Milford Senior Center runs their van, whether it's from 7 in the morning, 6 in the morning, till 8 o'clock at night. I'm sure it's not. This is the 13 hours a day that we're going to provide for you. And I know, if I could just have a show of hand, how many people in this audience do not have their license? One. Two, do you all realize that when we do outreach, and a lot of the outreach that we do is at senior centers, and when we go to those senior centers, the hardest thing is to have somebody come up to me that just had either a child or their doctor or the registry of motor vehicles take their license away from them. You'd be better off to cut their legs off than take their license away from them. And what we try and do is, through our travel training program at the MWRTA, is give those people the sense of independence so they don't have to rely on somebody to get around, whether it's the town of Milford or to go into Boston to a medical appointment. So these are the things we have to look at down the road as far as who is going to use this bus. I think because of the demographics of the town of Milford, there is going to be a lot of people that are going to use this bus. And I'm going to tell you one thing right now. I live in the town of Holliston. I've lived there all my life so far. And the thing is that there are a lot of people in Holliston right now using our senior center van to go to medical appointments here in Milford. And if we can give a person the independence to be able to go to the Milford Hospital, because I think the Milford Hospital, and this is a personal opinion, I have doctors there, is a fantastic facility. It really is. And for me, if I was a cancer patient, if I don't have to go into Dana-Farber in Boston and I can go to Milford for the same treatment, that's a big relief for somebody out here in the suburbs. And I'll tell you another thing that we did, some sort of a verbal survey with people as to where would you rather go shopping? Would you rather go to the box stores in Milford or Framingham and Natick? And the reaction that I get 99% of the time is, I'd rather go to Milford because you don't have to fight that Route 9 traffic. Except for tonight when Eva and I were coming over here. If you had public transportation, we would have got here a lot faster. But, I mean, that's one of the other things, too, that you have to understand that a public transportation system does is it is a help to the environment because it's taking people off the road. And we are slowly changing our buses to compressed natural gas, which is emission-free. So in the next 5 years, our buses are going to be all CNG rather than gasoline. We don't even have any diesels anymore. So we're looking out for the environment in the future, and the future of, you know, you'll hear it all the time, our children.
I just, Lena, if you don't mind, I want to just supplement. I've done a very bad job at communicating two issues. The first is, as they said, there's no contract. We're looking at a year-long worth of a trial, but there's no contract. The MWRTA has very graciously said, if you want to pay annually fine, semi-annually fine, quarterly fine, monthly fine, however Milford wants to give the money is fine by them. So we just want to pay them on a monthly basis, and then each month decide, that's fine. And I don't think I've done a very good job at helping people understand, no contract, and we're looking at a one-year trial, and then to see how the system is working, and then what other funds besides, I hope these $75,000, money from the state legislature. And I will also add, I've begun discussions with the Mass DOT for what's known as Tiger Grants. This is the federal money available for local communities. So there's opportunities even further to bring that money down. The second thing I did a very bad job at is this map. Now, this is what I call the Yellow Pages map. I was asked to put up a map. So I just went through the town and listed every potential place the bus system could stop. We are not going to do an hour and 15 minute route, okay? This was only to show people, here's a town, here's how different places are, potential for running a route. The route is owned by the town of Milford, not the MWRTA. The town of Milford gets to decide the route that we use, and only. So after a month, if we decide whatever route we're using isn't optimal, for whatever reason, we'll change the route. And then a month later, if that's still not optimal, we'll change the route again. And we will keep working on optimizing the route until, you know, the feedback we're getting, you know, is substantial in the favor of the route, all right? So please, sample only, not for anybody's thinking that this is final. Lena?
Well, everyone received that in the mail, so everyone felt that, wow, this doesn't look right. So it was just an example of what you're saying.
Very much.
An example of what you were doing.
Very, very much, Lena.
And to your point, this is a tryout for a year.
Right.
So this $250,000 that we have to bring forward, plus the $75,000 that's going to be deducted from it, I take
yes.
that. That is for 1 year.
Right.
And then how will we know how it worked?
And
will there be some kind of a booklet or someone yeah. giving us some information on, okay, the year is over, let me tell you what happened.
Okay, let me turn that over to Bill.
What?
No, because...
No, this is what I proposed at my first meeting. And I promised I would call on my colleague, Brian, so I'm going to do that, but I want to answer your question. The first thing I think this needs, because it's comprehensive, it's complex, and anybody that represents the town of Milford at the MWRTA would need some guidance. So what I propose to the board is a public transportation committee. That committee could be made up of veteran service agent, a variety of different boards, and general citizens, riders, hopefully, that would bring back issues that we would then talk to the MWRTA about to improve quality of services, to make changes, to propose changes to routes, is what I envision that. Now, that commission has not been established because there isn't, frankly, a public transportation piece. But I envision that being established very quickly. I'd like to establish it going forward, even if this fails at town meeting, to see what the issues are, to bring a better proposal and a better proposal until we have something. Now, that's just my point of view. I said that I would call on Brian, so I'm going to do that next, and Brian can talk to some of the things that he's been dealing with. What's that?
Reporting. How we're going to answer Lena's question about the reporting that's going to go on to the Transportation Commission.
I'm not sure I understand it, so go ahead. You're talking about the feedback loop, feedback mechanism?
Yeah, data that's going to come to the town about ridership.
Yes. So in terms of metrics or performance metrics that lets us know what the ridership is like, all of that is automatic coming from the MWRTA. That will give you ridership information, but it's not going to give you everything you're asking for, because there are aspects of quality of service that could make this fail or make it incredibly successful that would not be within those numbers. So that's why I envision a commission telling us how well this is working and being members of this community to help whoever's representing us at the MWRTA.
I would think that would be the best way to go.
Yeah. So we'll get numbers and data from the MWRTA, and we'll be feeding back quality of service to the Public Transportation Commission is what I've proposed. Let me call on Brian. I know there's a lot of hands. Go ahead. There'll always be lots of questions, but I want to make sure I get to you.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you, Bill. And let me just try to put this in a little bit of historical perspective as to what's been going on with the town of Milford going back about 10 years in the MWRTA. And I also want to convince my good friend George that I'm not getting giddy up here at all. The MWRTA started, I believe, in 2007 when the state authorized the regional transit authorities. And they were after us in Milford since that time to be a member. At that point, and still, we have the Lyft bus that Carl talked about. And towards one of Joe's questions, there was a study done in 2006 in terms of proposed ridership, which indicated that there would be a fairly reasonable interest in Milford to continue the bus service. And also, we had another survey presented to us in 2012, again, all in the effort to try to get the town of Milford to join the MWRTA. But if I can just put this in perspective a little bit, it's not only dollars and cents, it's really about people. And I have the survey results from 2012, and I just want to read some of the comments, because those people need to be represented. We need to hear their voice. We need to know why this is such an important service. These are just general comments from a full survey in 2012. I need this bus route for college. Without it, I wouldn't be able to get to class. I have a disability, cannot drive. It would be great to be able to get to work. I really depend on the Milford bus, and I don't know what I'd do without it. Milford needs this service. Everyone living in the town does not own cars to travel back and forth to work. keep the bus. At that point, there was a question as to whether or not that Lyft bus was going to continue. If this bus is discontinued, I will be out of a job. Have worked at Framingham State for 25 years. Every morning this bus is packed, standing room only. Many people, students, would be affected if the bus discontinued. Bus has to stay open or I'll be homeless. Please keep it going. I just took a job, thinking I was going to be able to get there. They take the bus away, what will I do? I mean, these are real people. This is what's going on out there. There's no other transportation. If this route was to end, I would lose my job. It's fine the way it is. If anything, you should be adding more bus runs. This is 2012. I think this is ridiculous that I'm even filling this survey out right now. I finally have a stable job, and now I have to worry about losing it. Please keep this going so I can work and feed my kids. Need to stay on. It helps me a lot to get to school in the morning, have this route to Milford come twice rather than just once. Would have to move to where transportation is possible. Keep the bus route so those in need can ride and not move. I'm a disabled American veteran, and I use bus and train to the VA hospital for doctor's appointments and job interviews. Without a bus, I have no transportation, and without transportation, I can't get a job. I do not have a car. Just got permanent job after 16 months as a temp, more buses per day. So that was a survey that we were presented with in 2012, and there's a lot more comments there. Just a couple of seconds, please, and then we'll open it up to the questions. Since that time, I think all of us know, I think we've undergone an economic expansion in the town of Milford. We've got a twin engine in our town. We've got an excellent medical facility that provides great services to this entire region. It's no longer Milford Hospital. I call it Milford Hospital, but it's really not. It's the Regional Medical Center for Southern Central Massachusetts. In addition to that care, trying to get folks to that hospital to get the care they need, it's our largest employer. The commitment to development that that institution has made to the town of Milford is unmatched. That employer came to us and said, look, public transportation is essential for our continued success. I believe the continued success of Milford economically and regionally depends on the continued success of Milford Regional Hospital. So to me, when your largest employer, when your medical provider comes to you and says, this is a service that this community needs, myself as a selectman have to look at it very, very seriously, and the board did. So from that point, we decided to join the MWRTA as a member, and towards Lena's point, there is no contract because it's an association. We're part of an association. We're guided by their bylaws, by their regulations, but we also have the choice of services. We can choose one bus, we can choose zero buses, we could choose 50 buses if we wanted to. We're part of the association. The association can stop at any point. So the plan going forward, which was formulated in the last year or so, spearheaded by Harold Rhodes and the Commission on Disability, and also the Board of Selectmen, was to join the MWRTA, become familiar with the services they have, bring Milford into the 21st century with public transportation. We're one of the few communities that doesn't have it. And it's really, as you can see, it's more than just, you know, a commuter bus. It's more than just to get to the T. It's within the community, and it's expanding outside of the community. Bring that transportation to the town of Milford. It's on a year-to-year commitment. So the idea was, and the chairman's indicated, to set up a review commission, which I think is a good idea and should go forward. It can be analyzed at the end of the year. We get information from the MWRTA, not only in terms of how many people use it, where they get on, where they get off. So we're able to evaluate this month to month if we want to, quarterly, half a year, whatever. The cost is $250,000. Yes, that's right. It is going to cost some money. But, you know, and Bill hit on it. You can make the same argument. I don't have any more kids in school. Why should I pay for the school system? I mean, if you take that sort of separatist approach, you come apart as a community. I mean, we're here for each other. We're here to analyze what we can do for everybody to make the community better. So the question you have to ask yourself, really, is not so much how much it costs per person and all that sort of thing, because you can do that with everything. It's really, is this the kind of service that we want to bring to the town of Milford, at least for an opportunity to look at it? We're not married to it for perpetuity. It's going to be analyzed year to year. When our largest employer says, this is something the community needs, this is something that we need to deliver our services, is it worth a look? I think it is. Now, the hospital, through their Chennai group, there's a relationship there. It's a distant one, but it's part and parcel of their investment into the community, has stepped forward, and they're going to be giving $75,000. So the cost is not $250,000, it's $175,000. That's the money that the town's going to be looking at right now. Representative Fernandes is working on some other things that can reduce that cost for fiscal 17, but that's not carved in stone, and I don't want to be the one to mislead anybody saying that, you know, we're going to get this benefit, we're going to get that benefit. Things are working. If something happens on that, it can only benefit the town economically. But right now, right here, that's where we stand. Those are the numbers. So as we look towards it going forward, the consensus on the Board of Selectmen is it's a year commitment. There's analysis that's going to be done to see whether or not it's effective, whether or not it's serving the needs that we want. Is it something that we should continue? Is it something that we should try to perfect? Or is it something that we should stop? But I think it's worth a try. I think it's time to try to look at it. When you get these kinds of comments from people, it's worth a try. So that's sort of my perspective on this. And the grant application, yes, it's a one-year grant, but it's available for 3 years. So we can reapply next year. And knock on wood, if everything goes forward, I think that we could have the same success that we had this year. But again, that's the process. That's where we're at right now.
Do you want to take the question,
Bill? Yeah.
And you know, one other thing I wanted to mention, people talked about different bus services. That was being provided solely by the town in lieu of something like this. That was one of the first questions I asked. I asked our financial director to work with Harold to work up those costs. And it was, if we did a similar bus route to this and we just matched that, what would it cost the town to implement this? And the number that Zach Taylor came up with, our finance director, was $410,000 a year. Because obviously the buying power of one community versus a system that the MWRTA provides, it couldn't match their overhead and their ability to spread out those costs among multiple towns. So that was one of the math questions that was asked earlier. Now, this young lady with the green headband, green hair.
I don't have a question. I actually want to make an observation based on, I think it was George that talked about the senior center and the buses and all of that. I think something that everyone needs to realize, this is not just seniors and disabled people, especially in Milford. I think if you polled how many people do not have a driver's license in Massachusetts, I mean in Milford, Mass, okay, I'm talking every age, not just seniors. There's a huge population that does not have a legal driver's license. This bus can help those people. It's not just, and then it can help them get jobs or even to the hospital, all of those things. I mean, I think that you really need to look at it from the big picture. The senior center is going to serve the seniors and potentially the disabled, but it's not going to serve the entire town. And I think there's a lot of people that need to use that bus.
Thank you. Lady in black there?
Well, first I want to applaud everybody for the job they're doing. My name is Jessica.
Hi, Jessica.
I know in Needham, we have something where my grandparents live, we have something called the ride, and it helps me get to wherever I want. And it's like you call the night before and you reserve your ride wherever you want to go, and they walk you to the door because I have a disability and I can't drive. And it's a subsidized fare, and they get you to and from where you need to go. And so
I think what she's trying to say is, living in Milford, we've been residents for 26 years. She can't get any here. She's a shut-in.
You're home
unless
now.
Unless I take her.
Unless my mom brings me, or unless my best friend brings me somewhere, you're kind of homebound. And I know friends that even can't get to their prescriptions or can't get to their hospital appointments. And I know it's like a sense of independence for me to be able to go to the grocery store and get my groceries on my own, or go get my nails done. I would like that. Mm-hmm. And I can't do any of that without my mom.
All doctor's appointments have to revolve around the ability for me to take her to them, because I have to, for me to take her from to get a prescription. If she wanted to do something, even like go to a movie, I'd have to drive her. So she's shut in.
And I have some independence.
Okay. First of all, I want to thank you for speaking this evening and giving a personal note. We're all talking in the abstract on, you know, about spreadsheets and costs, but that was a very human point that I appreciate you sharing this. I'm going to go to this gentleman right here with the paperwork and the tan pants. Khaki pants.
This is directed towards our friends at the MWRTA. While I also have some financial concerns as well, I feel this is worth it as long as we're connected to the greater community. And I share Selector Buckley's enthusiasm on what this could potentially do as we talk about revitalizing downtown, whatever the heck is going into the Kmart Plaza, potentially really helping, helping expand Milford and making that choice, right? So as I look at your current week Route 6 schedule, what I don't see is really that connection. I see one stop in Milford in the morning at 6:39 a.m., and I see one stop in the afternoon at 4:59.
That's correct. So, that's today.
That's today, yes.
Right.
So what my question is, if should everything, all this pass, what are you going to do to help expand that so that there is greater connectivity between the regional systems and the Milford bus system? And also, just as a thought, Route 5 connects down to EMC, which is right in our backyard as well. So could we, while I know this is in flux, potentially connect that as well so we have access to Route 6 and Route 5? Just some thoughts from you guys on that, please.
The first sort of swipe at the idea to come up with this here was to have some sort of a joining point for the current Route 6 with whatever the intra-bus is in the town of Milford. The thing that makes the most sense to us is, as we expand our routes, to have the Milford bus come down to Mission Springs in Holliston. Now, the administrator, his hope within the few years, once we find out how the Milford route goes, is to have a bus that will go in a straight line from Framingham to Milford, as one is going from Milford to Framingham. So they'll be passing each other. We have those routes currently right now. They're called routes A and B on the same route number. And it makes it more feasible and quicker to do that. What we have to do is try what we can to service a majority of the density of population in Milford, and who's going to use these buses. The Route 5, in order to make it come up here, and I know what you're talking about, to have it come out, is it Purchase Street?
Yeah.
To have it come out onto Purchase Street, that would have to be something that, again, down the road, whoever the representative from the town of Milford is, meets with the administrator, and they work out something. Is it possible to do this? One thing that you have to understand, as Bill had said, and I'm not going against what he had said, but you have to understand that if everybody in this room all of a sudden called us and said, I think that's a stupid idea to go up to Shadowbrook for the people up there. They're not going to take the bus. All the communication for the any changes that happen in Milford come through the designee of the chairman of the Board of Selectmen to the administrator and ultimately to the advisory board. And the advisory board, as I mentioned earlier, is made up of advisory board members from the 15 member communities. So in order to do that, and that's going to cost money in order to change something that severely, especially the Route 5, but it's something definitely to look at in the future. Maybe what we do is we have the Route 5 connect up to the Route 6 by coming down 85, going Fortune Boulevard, and then going down 16 to make that loop. In the meantime, the bus that's in the town of Milford is making a circle around, and maybe the connection for that bus and the bus that's going from Hawkington back into Holliston connects up at Target, just as an example. So if there's somebody here from the press, don't mention that in the paper right now. But that's the thing that we need to look at in the future. When we started out in Wellesley, for instance, and you probably don't want to hear about the town of Wellesley, but that took a long time to figure out that route because it was the same thing. There was a transportation group that sat at a table, and I think what they did was they took dots and the town of Wellesley's map, and they were throwing the dots at the map to say, yeah, I think that there should be a stop here, there should be a stop here. There were so many stops that were changed, and at the time, I was the one going out and putting the signs up to say that these are where the bus stop signs. Now, all of a sudden, we've got to take them down because it's not working in that location, and it does take time.
Carl, could you talk about the 3/4 mile if somebody needed to dial up?
Oh, yes.
It is part of.
Yeah, Mr. Buckley brings up a great point. According to ADA requirements, that's the Americans with Disabilities Act, if we have a fixed route on Congress Street, for instance, and I can't commit to memory as to where we had one, but and somebody off of Congress Street that's within 3/4 mile from the fixed route, what the bus can do is, as long as they're contacted and the person has a documented disability through our call center, we can go within 3/4 mile to pick that person up off of a fixed route. So that takes care of the people that feel that they're out in the boondocks. We're right close to it, but we're not going to be able to walk to the bus to get the bus.
Okay.
I have a
question. Pam.
Thank you. You mentioned before Monday through Friday. What about the weekends?
No, go ahead. That's entirely up to the town of Milford as to if they. It's going to cost more money to add a day, because the figure that we gave of the 250,000, actually 249 something, is it's governed on the number of hours that we operate within the town of Milford. So if you want to add a day. We don't have any service in any town on Sundays, but we do have a lot of service in different towns for Saturdays. And again, if that happens, that there is a need for, you know, there's a full complement of requests from the residents of the town that they'd like to see Saturday service, that information has to go to the selectman's office, which will in turn Mr. Buckley, if he's the designee as the representative for the RTA board, will come to the administrator to increase it, and then the price will be accordingly.
Is the Charlie card free yet, and how much would it be for Charlie card?
The Charlie card, a regular Charlie card, there is expiration dates on them. There's different expiration dates for each one. Normally, it's a 10-year card. The senior Charlie cards are much less than that. I believe they're only 5 years. But what we would do is, one of the things that, if this goes through town meeting, and it's not a point of wasting time, because I go to other towns. I'm also the travel training coordinator. And the young lady, I'm sorry that she had left, because I would like to have had a little more expansion on what her disability was. But I deal with a lot of people with disabilities to get them on our fixed route buses so they don't have to depend on the ride or they don't have to depend on the senior center, and they have their independence on their own. It's surprising because our call center now that takes the calls for the people that take the rides, 40% of the employees in that call center have visual disabilities. We go from totally blind to legally blind. That these people are taking your calls and making your reservations. Because we believe highly in hiring people with disabilities. And all you have to do, I would invite anybody to come to Framingham, to 15 Blandin Ave, to have us show you around, to see the utilization that we have with people with all kinds of disabilities, from being in wheelchairs to visual impairments.
Okay, I see all the hands, so I want to get to all of you. There's a woman in the very far back in black, I think, and I'm going to call on her because she's been very persistent, and I've not heard from her yet.
My question was, just to expand on a previous question about the new service and the existing service right now, would the new service be in addition to the existing service or replace it? And that's where I was hoping I would get the answer when you asked the question.
My understanding is in addition, but I want to check that.
Okay.
It is. So it's in addition to the existing service.
Okay, that's great. So then we have more opportunities to ride.
It would be more.
Holliston to the Framingham MBTA. Now my next question is going back to weekend service. I'm interested in knowing if Holliston has talked about having weekend or Saturday service. Because Wilford can't get any further than Holliston if Holliston doesn't have weekend service. So I'm curious about what's going on in that town too.
Well, that's not necessarily true.
Okay.
Let me just say this. It's very possible, depending on what we negotiate, and it's prorated. If there were great demand for a Saturday service, I don't think we would be dependent upon Holliston necessarily to get to Framingham or to get to somewhere else.
All right. Then those
that's part of the negotiation.
Okay, that's great. So then those towns that do have Saturday service, like what brought upon the need for Saturday service so that we could be aware of that when we're thinking about it for our future?
What's typical demand for Saturday?
Typical demand for Saturday is employment. And also because of the vast area that we cover in the Framingham, Natick, and Marlboro area, there's a lot of facilities in those towns that people want to go shopping on a Saturday. What you could do in Milford is, unless you wanted to connect into the rest of the system, like the system map shows you that you were given earlier, you could keep that bus within the town of Milford, just taking you to the locations like Target and TJ Maxx and all of these other box stores, and even the downtown area with the smaller shops who might want to have a sidewalk sale. So this is something that the negotiations has to come from the selectman's chair designee.
Okay.
You're going to designate yourself?
That's the plan, I guess. Let me ask John Seaver, because I've seen his hand up, and I'm intentionally, by the way, not calling upon, and I got to tell people this, not calling upon people that have already asked a question, because I'm trying to get first questions from other people that haven't spoke yet. I apologize. I'll just let you know my process. John, please.
Thank you, Jim and Bill. Thank you. Let me say this. My view is this. Disabled and seniors should be the focus of who we want to have. I don't think we can be all things to all people, but if we could, that would be great. But we should certainly try to help seniors and disabled, right? So let me ask this question. Here's the problem.
Who are you asking, John?
Well, let me make one more statement, and I'll ask the question. What I've concluded is most seniors and most disabled won't take the bus. Why? What I usually do is I turn to my mother, who's a lifelong Milford senior, 88 years old, and I look what won't she do? She lives on Richmond Ave, and she'd have to walk a half a mile all the way down through Town Park to come to the closest bus stop, which is at Memorial Hall, a half a mile. She can't walk a quarter of a mile, so she's not going to be walking a half a mile. And she's the typical senior. She's healthy, and she lives in a single-family home. She doesn't live in a group home where the bus is going to come, so she has to walk there. Then she has to wait. Then she has to take the bus. Let's say she's just going to the Milford Hospital. Right, just take the bus that's proposed, 20 stops all the way to Target, all the way to the Hollister line, back through Milford, and then all the way up to the hospital. It's at least a half hour. She goes to the hospital, that's another hour, and then she comes out of the hospital, and what happens? She misses the bus, it just left. So what happens? It's another hour, hour and a half of wait. Right? This is an 88-year-old woman who's going to have to wait. This is a typical senior. So she now waits another hour and a half or hour at the hospital. She gets on the bus. It takes her all the way back to Memorial Hall. And guess what? Now it's cold and snowy and it's dark. So she has to walk home through the town park to get home. That's about 5 or 6 hours.
John, why didn't you just give her a ride?
Well, that's who, fortunately, she drives and she... But at some point, she might not be able to drive. So seniors live in single-family homes. They're all going to have to walk to these bus stops. And it's very difficult for most seniors. Now, let's talk about disabled. Let's talk about disabled. Why won't a disabled take this? Now, think about it. We got a 29 or 30-stop run. And all of a sudden, we've got three or four disabled that we're going to have to deviate a mile and a half to pick up one senior, then another mile and a half for another senior, right? 3/4 of a mile to their house, and then back. All of a sudden, we're going to have 34, 35, 36 stops. It's going to be a 3-hour bus ride. Okay? Plus, so...
John, I just want to caution you. And I work in Framingham every day. I see the MWRTA buses go by all the time. There's a fair amount of seniors and disabled people that take that, but I want to caution you, just say, the model works. It's worked in other communities. Now, I don't know, I can't, to your point, I don't know whether this model will work in Milford.
Let me just finish, and then, so, now let's take a disabled person, all right? Let's take somebody...
But I want to get to a lot of people, so if you could...
I'll talk, that's a typical senior,
zip to the front.
That's real world, that's not some statistic, that's real world. Let's take a dialysis patient. Do you think a dialysis patient who at 3 times a week has to go to the dialysis center down on South Main, when they get out of the dialysis center, what, they're very weak. They can't wait and take a bus. They got to go right home and go to bed. That's right. What they need is door-to-door by appointment service. And that's what they need. Well, that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about a fixed bus. Let me just finish. Everybody's had their thing. So there's a lot of disabled that won't be able to use it because it's just not practical. It doesn't work. Okay? I'll just end it.
Okay. Thank you. Gentleman in the purple. That's it.
What is the time? We've been told this is a proposed route, but there has to be a start time. What is the start time at Temple Bell Tour in Holliston? Is that time fixed? I'm assuming there's a bus coming from Framingham to Holliston that currently goes to the temple there.
Right, but that's only twice a day. But
I think we need not to be fixed on the temple as the location.
Okay.
Right now, you have to understand that first route, if you look on the sheet, that first route that leaves our central hub in the morning is 6:00 in the morning. The important thing that you have to understand is this is more of a commuter time that we start. And it originates in Milford, in Framingham, and comes right to Milford. Okay? So what we want to do is we want to maintain that bus route right now the way it is. Okay?
And
it might be expanded on because we might need to go to another area where there's a lot of people that would have a reason to use the bus. And we don't want people that live out in Shadowbrook, for instance. I hate to keep picking on the Shadowbrook people, but we don't want them to come down and park in the parking lot at the town hall, because if one person does it, then it's going to expand, and then there's going to be no parking at the town hall. So we want to make sure that what we do for the routes is going to be beneficial for all of the people in Milford, not just a small few.
What I'm trying to figure out is what time the Milford bus would start as it connects to the rest of the system.
It will start at 6 o'clock in the morning.
And runs to?
6. Well, by the time it gets to Milford, according to the schedule, 6:30.
It would be 6:30.
Okay, but I'm not talking about the current Route 6 bus.
But that's what will start the Milford route. Then there will probably be another bus that leaves, the next bus that leaves at 7:18 from the central hub might come all the way to Milford and stay in Milford and do that proposed route. Okay? This is something that is very difficult here to explain to people as to how we are going to set this up. We want to make sure that we set it up in the most beneficial way during the day. And as our administrator says, is what he would love to see is to have it so that the buses are crossing each other. So that one is going to Framingham, one's coming to Milford. One's going to Framingham, one's coming to Milford. But we're still able to service that area within the town of Milford. You know, even if we started out simple, and we still did that 13 hours a day, 5 days a week, and went from Framingham to the Milford Hospital, Framingham to the Milford Hospital. Anybody on the outskirts is not going to benefit from this at all. So we have to make it that it's going to benefit all. We're not a taxi service, so you have to understand that. So we're not going to go and pick up Mrs. Seaver's mother, Mr. Seaver's mother, at her house. But if she has some sort of a disability or her age inhibits her from being able to walk to a bus stop, as I mentioned earlier, she's covered under the ADA, that we will go that deviation of 3/4 mile to pick her up. So she doesn't have to walk home at night. On that particular example, it's curb to curb, not door to door, like the ride is in other communities that we serve. In Holliston, for instance, they do not have the ride. What they depend on is their senior van. We have two senior vans in Holliston, and they handle a lot of the ridership that the ride does now in other communities. And that's what we'd like to see the Milford senior van do. Somebody that has dialysis, and I'm probably one of the only ones in this room that can speak to dialysis, because I did it for almost 2 years until I got my kidney transplant. You do not feel well enough afterwards to take a fixed route bus, but that's why we have the senior van, to pick that person up and take them from their dialysis and take them home. They're not going to put them to bed, but they're going to take them door to door.
We've not talked about the buses we've talked about from a senior's perspective, the two buses, right? We've not.
No, we haven't. That's next.
Still in, okay.
That's next.
All right, there are some people's hands I've seen up quite a bit. I'll get to you in a minute, the gentleman with the beard here, but I've got a call on the gentleman with his hand up right now in the middle, right there. I know you've had your hand up, and I apologize.
Well, as I said at the beginning, I work for a decision called Healthcare for All.
Speak up.
I can't hear.
Why don't you come to the thing? Some people project differently, so we want to get you on the microphone. You're very welcome.
As I said at the beginning, I work for an organization called Healthcare for All, and Healthcare for All is a statewide organization. My position is called Outreach and Organizing Manager, so I have to do with a lot with community education, but also with responding to crisis in the community. This is where the organizing comes along. My word of advice to all of you is do not take what you have in Milford for granted. Because in my work, I've been in North Adams, where the local hospital was closed. I don't know if you've heard about that. The local hospital said on Friday, we are filing for bankruptcy. We're closing on Monday. And so they closed on Monday. And so now there is a whole community coalition that is trying to reopen full inpatient services for that community because the hospital, the facilities ended up being bought by another hospital that was 45 minutes away in Pittsfield, and they opened emergency services, right? Now this issue with community hospitals seems to be a trend in the state. I mean, I don't want to give bad news, and I know that our hospital here in Milford is very soundly healthy financially, But the truth is that community hospitals are struggling in the state in terms of financing when compared to the large teaching hospitals in the state. There is, I've been also in Ware, in Hampshire County, with in community forums just like these, with a lot of seniors that need the services of the hospital, and Bay State, who owns the hospital, is planning to downsize that hospital. They are going to, you know, take all the outpatient services away, and they are just going to have an emergency services there. And it breaks my heart that I get into that community and there are no youth. It's all senior citizens trying to keep their hospital open. And the youth are not there because they have to leave. They need access to colleges. All of us know that this is story. So don't take what you have for granted. We have a regional hospital here. I worry that it's a half an hour from Metro West Regional Hospital, right? So there is two very strong hospitals side by side, but we also have a regional high school. And we need to empower these youth to become all that they can be, and we need to give them access. Otherwise, they're going to leave this community. Now, my other word of advice is, you know, I'm that guy that takes that bus at 6:30, right at the desk is in the morning, right? I work downtown. I work on one Federal Street in Boston. And I tell you, you want more people to have access to high-end salaries in Boston. Those monies come to Milford if people live here in Milford. Otherwise, your economy will not be all that it can be. And that bus is essential. I have my own issues with the Transportation Authority, you know, because the bus drivers seem to have this great capacity to drive the route and come to Framingham right when the commuter rail is leaving. And sometimes they come a little early. They come like 5 minutes early, and I think, I'm going to make it to the train today. But when they hit Holliston, they stop for 4 or 5 minutes, and then they come to Framingham right when the train is leaving. I don't know how they do it, but they have a great ability, right? And in winter, you have to wait a half an hour, 40 minutes for the next train. But the system works. And when you look at this map, don't just look at, you know, don't just look at who's coming. You know, this is a connection both ways. You want people from all these towns to come to Milford, right? The Chamber of Commerce overwhelmingly said it would benefit our local businesses because people want to use the businesses in Milford. So all the conversation that we're having about taxes and so on, we never talked the whole night about businesses paying more taxes because they sell more, because more people are patronizing these businesses. We want that. All of us want that. Thank you.
Oh, let's see. Somebody who's had their hand up quite a long time. I'm sorry, right here. You're right, the beard here. Not Billy. You. Yes.
I have three questions. How many times a day will the bus go, the route that goes around Milford, how many times a day do you plan on having that route going around Milford? Will there be signs posted, shelter in place for people to hide during inclement weather? And it was talked about earlier this evening about if the town of Milford thinks it's not working, we can get out of it. Who in this town, what body, what person has that final decision, yes or no, and will the community be able to have an input on that?
So we've not talked through all of that, but I do view that as part of the Public Transportation Commission that I've talked about forming. So it would be the town through the Board of Selectmen, through that commission, through the Board of Selectmen. Let me see, you talked about number of routes. There are 13 loops daily.
13 times a day,
yes.
Once an hour.
Yes.
It could be more.
It could be, but I'm committing to the smaller number. 13. And I'm sorry, there was a third question. Oh, shelters. Thank you. Shelters is a great question. So remember that this is very fluid. In the first year, you can imagine how we might tweak and adjust this. I think there are going to be some things that are known or understood at the beginning, at the onset of any public transportation route. I think you can be rest assured there would be a route that would likely not change for a fixed stop near Town Hall or at Town Hall, as an example. I think that you can guarantee that it's going to stop at the hospital. I think there are certain guarantees that it'd likely get to the library. I think there are some things that we could look on the map and say, you know, a lot of things are going to be fluid, but these things are pretty, we're pretty fixed that these are going to stay put. That would be where my recommendation, the shelters go first. Otherwise, we'd find ourselves not only moving bus routes as we came to understand the system. And remember, there's a ridership learning process, right? So the community learns, the riders learn, they figure out better ways. They'd rather go here than go there. I can either park my car there or I can walk here, whatever it is. There's a community learning process. There's also the MWRTA learning process to understand our demographics. So I don't think we'd put a lot of shelters up first year. Now, granted, these shelters that we're talking about, they're extruded aluminum, powder coated, they're bubbles on top, relatively easy to move, but still, there's some effort to move those. We wouldn't want to be moving them every couple of weeks. Scott's assured me he can do it in like 2 minutes. And I do want to say, Lena's on the planning board, and so if you want to know what's going to Kmart, I'll give you her cell phone number. She knows.
We don't know yet.
Woman right here, yes.
This is kind of simplistic. It really doesn't reflect accurately. I went to the assessor's office today, and they told me they sent out 10,000 quarterly bills for 10,000 parcels in the town, real estate, and plus 760 businesses. So I kind of did a little math, and this isn't right because you really need to know how much per thousand. But it comes to about $17 a year. I can give up a few cappuccinos if you can.
I'm going to call on Rob and Billy, Mike, third, because I haven't heard from either of you. You had four questions?
Oh, no, I can go four.
What's that? You want to go? There's some other people. I'm just letting those people know that had their hands up. Mike Visconti, your third. So, Rob, go ahead.
All right, so I'm going to come back to the very beginning. I think you mentioned this map looks like a spider. And you know, I think, Brian, you were talking about some letters that talked about getting into Boston. And I think you commuted to Boston. So all of these routes that I'm looking at here are one-way major routes, even the Wellesley line. You know, it's up Route 16. You know, so I'm wondering, is there any community, Holliston, you said, does not have a circuit. You use dial-a-ride. You know, does Southborough, does Northborough, does any other community have what we're proposing here, or are we being trailblazers in terms of having a circuit within a suburb?
Intra-bus route.
And I'm not talking about you know, a major Needham or Newton or whatever. I'm saying the suburbs.
The two that have the intra system are Framingham and Natick.
Okay, which is around, if I look on here, Shoppers World Inn. In terms of numbers of stops, the dots on here might be 5, 6, 8. It's not 30.
Right.
And it's not going off into local communities. It's Shoppers World, it's EMC. You know, if you wanted to extend, for example, the line that's currently coming into town now, up to the hospital, I'd be totally on board with that. You know, staying along Route 16. The intent of trying to pick up all of Milford right now, when nobody else is doing it, and we're assuming we're going to have some ridership where there's no basis for coming up with a number. I think Lena's point is right. We may be a little bit too early to bring this to town meeting because it really hasn't been fully baked. So, no questions.
Okay.
Other than, is there another town that has something similar to this?
And the two that we mentioned are the two. Are there any other intra?
Yeah. Marlborough.
Okay, Marlborough has it as well.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. And the ridership.
Very much so.
Yeah.
Full buses all the time.
I'm sorry, say that again?
Full buses all the time.
Okay.
What do you call a full bus? 16, 18 people? Only a 16-passenger bus.
Okay, I'm sorry, I said Billy next, and then Mike Visconti third.
For each year that the town wanted to continue this agreement, would they need town meeting approval?
Yeah, I guess that's the easiest way to say it. For every year you need appropriation, you need town meeting approval. So it'd be a separate line item. That's a good question. Mike Visconti.
Three questions. I'll be brief. First one is.
Can't hear you, Mike.
My first question is along the lines of Mr. Seva's question. Since you're touting the ability to get people to work as one of the benefits of this service, let's say, for example, if I might, that I was fortunate enough to get a job at Milford's largest employer, doing what I don't know, maybe causing trouble. But in any case, and let's say my shift started at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, at what time should I leave my house to walk the 3/4 mile uphill to the closest bus stop to be assured that I would get to my job at 3 o'clock at Milford's largest employer, and not an hour before and not an hour after? That is my first question. Secondly, we talked about the buses being CNG powered, and regardless of whether they're CNG powered or some other powered by some other source, would changes in the cost of fuel affect the fares that were previously stated? And if so, would they be affected directly, whether fuel goes up or down? Thirdly and lastly, I noticed there were at least two or maybe three stops, proposed stops, and I know the stops aren't cast in stone yet, but I noticed there were at least two and possibly three proposed stops on Route 140, and I'm wondering if safety concerns had been considered when proposing stops on 140, which as you all know is a very heavily traveled, high-speed state highway. That's all I have. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
I don't have any way to tell you what time to leave your house. You may qualify for the pickup if you're within 3/4 mile, but I'm not going to be able to tell everybody here what time they should leave their house to get a particular.
How will you get home?
What's that?
How will you get home if the transportation stops at 7:30?
Yeah, this is most certainly not a 7x24 operation. So.
It's a little misleading to say people could get to their jobs all over if they can get there but can't get home.
Right. So what we're talking about is service that ends at what time, Carl?
7 p.m.
7 p.m. So if it's, let me, and I don't want to mislead anybody, if you start work before 6 o'clock or end work after 7 p.m., you would need an alternative. This would not necessarily be the service for you, unless you wanted to participate to get to work and then do something different for your ride home. So if somebody, for example, as Mike pointed out, hypothetical, worked at Milford Hospital, largest employer in town, and they worked 3 in the afternoon till 7 at night or 10 at night, 10 at night would be better, they could get a ride to the facility, but they would need to seek an alternate plan for getting home.
One last question.
We're going to need to wrap up. The hand that's in the back.
Tom Rose, I'm just curious, has there been any kind of a study initiated to determine how many folks from this area use commuter rail, and what the service level would be from Milford to any of the commuter rail stops?
That's a great question.
And the next step is, if that number is big enough, You know, you've got to link the commuter rail right out there in Depot Street. That's the Franklin Branch. And that's owned by the MBTA. And there it sits as a maybe three-night-a-week freight operation. The CSX coming down from Franklin. Just a thought.
Yeah, no. And there's a fair amount of the community that every time they hear that freight whistle, leap out of bed and are struggling with that process as they get to intersections. So it's a balancing act, right? I understand your point, though. And I want to go to your original point. Your original point with that data should be readily available from the MBTA, ridership by community. And can you make a note of that, Rick? I think we can get that pretty easily. We know somebody at the MBTA who happens to be a member of the Board of Selectmen. So we should be able to get that without much to do.
What is their final words?
You do.
No, you do.
Oh. So as you can see, we're going to wrap up because it's now past the time we said we would hold this. Members might be available for a few minutes after if you have a personal question you want to ask. As you can see, this is a hard process because there is no absolute answer to where every stop should be, how many stops there should be. And some of it, and I don't want to say a blind leap of faith, but we have to do the best we can. When these stops were developed, they were developed with John Pillar, our veterans agent. They were developed with, I'm sorry, who were some of the other people that participated?
Milford Housing.
Yeah, the Milford Housing.
Churches.
Okay, various churches.
Everybody.
Okay, so there were a lot of people, and there were various stakeholders. Now, not all the stakeholders were involved in setting where each stop might be. So we haven't necessarily canvassed every stakeholder group. I think that needs to be done further. We're not going to implement this unless it has a high chance of success. So with the right planning, with the right understanding of where the stops should be, and knowing that no matter what we put on a map today, tomorrow, next week, with the best of planning, I can get together with one of the best planners around, Lena McCarthy. We can put together all the brain power we want. 2 months later, we're going to be changing some of those stops. I can promise that. As the system evolves, as the ridership learns, MWRTA learns, there are improvements that can be made. First of all, no system should be stagnant anyway. So we should be improving the model as fast as we need to, but not so fast that the ridership doesn't get an opportunity to learn and understand. So it's a delicate balance. I appreciate the comments. I appreciate the challenges that were put forth. And I appreciate all the town meeting members that came out, the citizens that came out, the department heads. I think you may have learned something from hearing from other people that may prompt other questions. We want to hear from those. If there's a survey that needs to be redone from department heads or committees, please do that. If something provoked thought, please submit those to the town administrator and just update your form. Scott wanted to ask a question or make a comment. And that, with that, we're going to end.
I was kind of waiting until the end because this more affects my department.
Yes.
Now you're talking, you're going to have shelters at every bus stop. You don't know that?
No, I don't. I didn't mean to say that. So I hope nobody right, got
so
that
just
impression.
Just general maintenance questions because obviously we don't know how to handle this.
Right.
Somebody's going to have to keep it clean. Somebody's going to have to do the snow removal, the ice removal.
Exactly.
All this is going to come, you know, as a cost to my department. I don't know what that cost is, but that will be an added cost.
Yes.
Whether it's time, employees, or a machine. So not knowing all the stops where they are, I mean, we have to plow sidewalks that go to bus stops.
Correct.
I don't expect people to walk down the road if there's nowhere to walk and, you know, during a snowstorm.
And so that raises a good point, and it's one I've raised at board meetings as well. We need to get an understanding of the route. We need to get an understanding of where shelters might be, because I'm an advocate for shelters. I think when we talk about the population that we're talking about, having them stand out in a snowstorm doesn't make a lot of sense, but we're not going to be able to put out shelters at every stop.